Dear brother and sister of Cornerstone Chinese Church, welcome to our Thanksgiving Sunday service, as well as our church anniversary celebration. Year 2020 is not easy for every one of us, but as a big family in Jesus Christ, we love each other, we miss each other, we pray for each other, we help each other, we receive the grace of protection, faith, hope, and love from our Heavenly Father together. Psalm 91, 1 to 4, the one who lives under the protection of the Most High dwells in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Himself will deliver you from the hunter's net, from the destructive plague. He will cover you with his feather. You will take refuge under his wings. His faithfulness will be a protective shield. Let's use our song to praise our God.
亲爱的中华友爱教会各位弟兄姊妹，欢迎你们来参加我们的感恩节联合崇拜，也都是我们教会的周年庆祝。2020年对我们每个人来讲都是相当不容易的。但是在主耶稣基督里面，我们作为一家人，我们彼此相爱，彼此挂念，彼此代祷，彼此帮助， 一同领受从天父而来的保护、信心、盼望和爱。 在诗篇91篇1到4节， 圣经说，住在至高者隐密处的，必住在全能者的荫下。我要论到耶和华说，他是我的避难所，是我的山寨，是我所倚靠的。他必救你，脱离蒲了引的网络 和毒害的瘟疫，他必用自己的灵幕来遮蔽你，你要投靠在他的翅膀底下。他的诚实是大小的盾牌。下边等我们一起用诗歌来赞美我们的神。亲爱的中华友爱教会各位弟兄姊妹，欢迎你们来到今天的感恩节联合崇拜，也是我们教会的周年庆祝。 2020年对于我们每个人来说都是相当的不容易，但是在主耶稣基督里面，我们作为一家人彼此相爱、彼此挂念、彼此代祷、彼此帮助，一同领受从天父而来的保护、信心、盼望和爱。诗篇91篇1到4节，圣经说：“住在至高者隐密处的，必住在全能者的荫下。”我要论到耶和华说， 他是我的避难所，是我的山寨，是我的神，是我所倚靠的。他必救你脱离蒲鸟人的网罗和毒害的瘟疫。他必用自己的翎毛遮蔽你，你要投靠在他的翅膀底下。他的诚实是大小的盾牌。下面，让我们一起用诗歌来赞美我们的神。
I want to praise the Lord. Dear Cornerstone Chinese Church family, we have not seen each other for over 8 months already. But we are thankful that we all are well. Yes, we have a lot to give thanks to. We have been protected from the virus. Many of us have grown in our relationship with God. Our ministries have been strong. Many are able to join other members online in Sunday school classes, in prayer meetings, in small group meetings, and even in sharing the gospel with friends online. Yes, we have a lot to give thanks to. But before we pray, the church board would like me to share our adjustment to our COVID-19 response. In order to align our church with guidelines recommended by the state, all fellowship gatherings and events shall not meet at the church. There will be a limit of 6 people allowed in the building. They shall follow all current state safety guidelines and protocols, such as wearing a mask and signing in. Pick up communion elements will be delayed to a later date. Church office hours will be suspended, which means the pastors may choose to work from home at their own discretion. These policies will continue through Sunday, December the 6th. As we continue to monitor the effects of the pandemic on our community and church family, the board will reassess these policies adjustments after this period. We encourage our church family to stay home as much as possible, only going out for essentials. We all play a part in helping stop the spread of COVID-19 in our communities. We also encourage you to remain vigilant in following the 3 W's: wearing a mask, wash your hands, and watch your distance. Cornerstone Chinese Church family, this morning the Cantonese congregation, the Mandarin congregation, and the English congregation will come together to worship God. We have Pastor Raj to preach the word. 4 members are invited to share their experience during this pandemic crisis. We pre-recorded everything and inserted subtitles wherever necessary so that all of us can worship together in spirit and in mind. As you use your house as the place of worship, as you use a smartphone, an iPad, or computer as the means to participate, remember that you are a priest to offer a sacrifice of praise to God through Jesus Christ. That is your fruit of lips in the name of Jesus. I'm going to lead the prayer, and I will use Cantonese, Mandarin, and English one after another. So let's bow our head and pray together with reverence.
亲爱的天父，感谢你喺瘟疫期间照顾我哋，供应我哋一切嘅需要，使我哋知道瘟疫之中点样生存，点样工作。父神啊，感谢你冇离弃我哋嘅教会，你唔单止保护我哋嘅弟兄姊妹平安，亦都俾我哋嘅关系更加密切。喺瘟疫嘅期间，你亦都使用我哋去祝福好多嘅人。父神啊，我哋为咗我哋政府，为咗我哋嘅医护人员，我哋感谢你，求你赐俾我哋智慧赐俾佢哋智慧，保护生命，特别系保护嗰啲健康脆弱嘅人。父神啊，我哋感谢你喺耶稣基督里面保守我哋嘅心怀意念，免受恐惧。我哋感谢你喺耶稣基督嘅复活里面赐俾我哋真正嘅平安同埋盼望。 求你帮助我们学到怎样分辨生命里面最宝贵的东西。亲爱的天父，感谢你在瘟疫期间照顾我们，供应我们一切的需要，使我们知道在瘟疫之中怎么样生存，怎么样工作。父神啊，感谢你没有离弃我们教会，你不但保护我们的弟兄姐妹平安，也让我们的关系更加密切。在瘟疫期间，你更使用我们祝福许多的人。父神啊，我们为我们的政府，为我们的医护人员感谢你，求你赐他们智慧，保护生命，特别是保护那些生命脆弱的人。父神啊，我们感谢你在耶稣基督里保守我们的心怀意念，免受恐惧。我们感谢你在耶稣基督复活里赐给我们真正的盼望。现在求你帮助我们学习学到怎么样分辨生命中最宝贵的东西。 Dear Father God, thank you for taking care of us during the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you for the abundance of food, water, and supplies in our home, and for the fact that we actually have a home that we love. Thank you for all the habits you help us develop, which allow us to survive and to be productive in the midst of uncertainty, and also allowed us to guard our mind and heart in Jesus Christ from fear and panic. Father, you haven't forsaken us and our church family. Thank you for protecting our brothers and sisters and for bringing us closer together, even though we are apart. Thank you for using us to bless many others even during the crisis of pandemic. Father God, thank you for the leaders in our government and for our health workers. We pray that they have the insight to protect lives, particularly the vulnerable in our midst. Help us be motivated by love rather than fear as we play a part in keeping our community safe and prosperous. Father God, we are thankful that this time of danger and disruption has reminded us of what is truly valuable in our lives, and that these dark times point us to true hope through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Thanksgiving service, as well as our church anniversary celebration for the year 2020. So glad you could join us at this time of celebration, this time of remembrance, and worshiping the Lord for all the good things that He has brought into our lives. Yes, this past year, especially these 8 months, have been very challenging, but we've also seen God's goodness and faithfulness to His church. And we're so glad that you are here to celebrate along with us. So I'll get into our message, and it's really a message of hope. It's a message of encouragement, and to see how God has led us and what God is calling us to do in the days and months ahead. When I say the word Viking, V-I-K-I-N-G, what comes to mind? For me, it conjures up people who lived off of the land, especially the coastal lands off of Scandinavia. To some degree, they were also like pirates in the Scandinavian areas of Europe, as they pillaged the coastal areas and towns and took over the cultures and the peoples of that area. However, the Vikings didn't see themselves that way. They thought of themselves as farmers and ranchers among those who lived off of the cattle, and the cattle was a source of their status symbol. 1,000 years ago, a group of Vikings led by Eric the Red set sail from Norway to the big Arctic island known today as Greenland. At the time, it was uninhabitable. But the Norse colonies in Greenland were able to thrive, reaching a population of 5,000 people. And they lasted for 450 years, and then they vanished. And so the question is, what caused them to vanish? Well, their precious cattle had grazed the fertile soils of Greenland. Actually, they pretty much used up all of the resources of Greenland, and they disappeared. The wind and the water carried away the topsoil, and the Norse people starved to death. This happened despite the fact that they were sitting on top of the richest resource, richest food source in the world. Do you know what that was? An ocean teeming with fish. In fact, all archaeological evidence suggests that the Norse would rather starve than eat fish. When archaeologists looked through the ruins of the Western settlement on Greenland, they found all kinds of animal bones, but no fish bones. They found the bones of newborn calves, meaning that the Norse, in that final winter, had given up on the future. They found bones from cows, suggesting that the Norse ate their cattle down to the hoofs. And they found the bones of dogs covered with knife marks, indicating that in the end, they had to eat their own pets. Strangely absent were the fish bones, right up until they starved to death. The Norse refused to change their diet. It's like what Virginia Satir, a therapist, once said, "Most people prefer the certainty of misery to the misery of uncertainty." People just don't like to change, unless you're a wet baby, and even then you cry about it. And yet our society today is going through great changes at a very rapid rate. What was unthinkable just a few years ago is quickly becoming the cultural norm. I mean, who would have thought that our kids and grandkids would be doing remote schooling, remote learning from home? And we as parents are also working remotely from home. Whether we like it or not, change is here in a big way. What does God want us to do when our world is going through such changes and it's changing so rapidly? Well, if you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me to Genesis chapter 12. It's a very familiar passage, but I'd like for us to think about this and celebrate and remember God's goodness and faithfulness to Abram as well as to us. In Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3, it reads, "Now the Lord said to Abram, 'Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I'll make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed.'" Now, this is commonly known as the Abrahamic Covenant. It is God's promise to Abram of land, of seed, and blessing. Land, seed, and blessing, which forms the foundation for the rest of the Old Testament. And it's a very important promise, but I want to focus on the two imperatives contained in this promise. There are two commands that activated the promise and changed the entire course of human history. There are two commands which helped Abraham face a world of change. And I believe it will help us to face the changes ahead of us today. The first command is found in verse 1, where God tells Abram, "Go from your country." When your world is changing, don't retreat, don't hide. No. What does he say? Point number 1, move ahead, move ahead. Leave the known, leave the familiar for the unknown and the unfamiliar. And that's exactly what God told Abraham to do. Go from your country, leave its wealth and affluence. Go from your kindred, leave the people you know and love. Go from your father's house, leave even your own family. Go away from all of this. God said, to the land that I will show you, God calls Abram to leave the known, leave the familiar, and advance towards the unknown and the unfamiliar. And then in verses 4 through 8. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old, and he departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring, I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there, he moved to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched its tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. So that is God's story of how God called Abram to move. Even though he was 75 years old at the time, Abram left the familiar for the unfamiliar. And that's what God calls us to do sometimes. One of the commentators says, our country is dear to us, our kindred dearer, and our father's house dearest of all. And yet they all must be hated. Jesus himself said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Does that mean we have to show animosity toward our families? Of course not. It just means that when Jesus says, go, we must be willing to go, to follow his voice, even if it means leaving our families, even if it means leaving those that are near and dear to us. An old farmer was fishing in a tub of water in his backyard. His neighbor saw it and chided him. Man, there ain't no fish in there. Why are you wasting your time like that? He said. Yes, came the reply. I know there isn't any fish in here, but it's just so powerfully convenient. Sometimes God calls us out of our comfort zone, convenient spots, so we can be more productive. And when the call comes, we must be ready to move. One of my favorite stories, and some of you in the English have already heard it, is of Joy Johnson, 86-year-old Joy Johnson. She was a veteran of 25 New York City marathons, who died a few years ago with her running shoes on. Johnson was the oldest runner in New York City's 2013 marathon. She fell at the 20-mile marker, but got up and crossed the finish line at about 8 hours. Then she returned to her hotel room, lay down with her shoes on, and she never woke up. Amazingly, Johnson didn't run her first marathon till the age of 61 years old. The only hint of the sport was the verse from Isaiah 40, verse 31, which hung on the kitchen wall in her family farmhouse in Minnesota. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. Ironically, for most of her life, Johnson didn't exercise much, even though she had been a career gym teacher. Then she took a 3-mile walk in 1986. That led to jogging and eventually competing in 10K races. By 1988, she had competed in her first New York City marathon. 3 years later, in 1991, she recorded her best time at age 64 of 3 hours and 55 minutes. A few years ago, she told a reporter about her exercise regimen. She would wake up at 4 a.m., drink her coffee while reading her Bible, and then set out for an 8-mile pre-dawn run. She said, "When you wake up, it can either be a good day or a bad day." Ms. Johnson said, "I always say it's going to be a good day." As a committed follower of Christ, she ran every day that Sunday so that she could attend church. Johnson sang hymns to herself to pass the time while running. According to Johnson's daughter, she was always a happy runner, and besides her faith and family, this was something she loved the most. I don't know about you, but I love Miss Johnson's attitude. She was willing to try something new at age 61, and she enjoyed it right up until the day she died with her shoes on. Abraham was 75 years old. He left his country for a land that God would show him. And Moses was 80 when he obeyed the call of God to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt. My dear friends, it's never too late, and you're never too old to start a new journey with the Lord. So when he says go, move forward. Go forward into the future with a holy boldness, confident that God will be with you all the way. It's the only way to face the changes that are here and that are coming. Don't run away and hide. Instead, go, number two, point number two. Go enrich the lives of others. Go enrich the lives of others. Don't go grumbling and complaining. Instead, go out there and enrich other people's lives. Go share the joy of our Lord Jesus Christ. Go share your faith with boldness and courage and joy. And that's what God called Abraham to do. God said to Abraham, go from your country. And then in verse 2, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. Or better, and so be a blessing. And it's an imperative in the Hebrew, the second command we have in these verses. Be a blessing. God promised Abraham tremendous blessings, and God fulfilled his promise to Abraham. God made him into a great nation and gave him a great name, just like he said he would. Now, why did God so richly bless this man? So he could keep it to himself and hoard it all? No, God so richly blessed Abraham so that Abraham could turn and be a blessing to others. God never blesses his people so that they can hoard it for themselves. Rather, God wants us to be channels of his blessings to other people. Just like Abraham, God calls us to share his blessings, to bless others with the blessings he has given us. At age 12, Robert Louis Stevenson was looking out into the dark from his upstairs window. He was watching a man light the street lamps. Stevenson's governess came into the room and asked what he was doing. And he replied, "I'm watching a man cut holes in the darkness. I'm watching a man cut holes in the darkness." Do you know, that's exactly what God calls us to do. He calls us to cut holes in the spiritual darkness of our world. When I share this illustration, many of you may know who this is. Some of you may not. Especially for those of you who've been born after 1990, you may not recognize this name. But for those of us who are older, this is a very familiar name. You see, in 1965, a thin, soft-spoken man walked into the Pittsburgh's WQED, the nation's first public television station, to pitch a show targeting young children. The concept was simple enough. convey life lessons to young children with the help of puppets, songs, and frank conversations. It didn't sound like much, but the man's name was Fred Rogers, and the program was Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. Fred Rogers, as Gabe Lyons talks about in his book, The Next Christians, is described as a restorer. Now, a restorer is someone who views the world as it ought to be. Faced with the world's brokenness and hurt, restorers are provoked, not offended, according to Gabe Lyons. They work to make the world a better place by creating, not criticizing, and by being countercultural, not relevant. In fact, using this definition, Rogers may have been one of the greatest American restorers of the 20th century. Rogers got into television because he hated the medium. During spring break of his senior year in seminary, he watched television for the first time, and what he saw repulsed him. "I got into television," he said, "because I saw people throwing pies at each other's faces. And that to me was such demeaning behavior. And there's anything that bothers me, it's one person demeaning another. And that really makes me mad." In the wake of World War II, Fred Rogers worried that many of the common TV programs would create a generation of emotionally bankrupt Americans. Faced with the decision to either sour on television itself or work to restore the medium, he chose the latter. He dropped out of seminary and began pursuing a career in broadcasting. 14 years later, he would create one of the most loved American television shows of all time, and one that would shape entire generations of children, including me. Rogers was a devout Christian that almost never explicitly talked about faith on the air, but a show infused society with the beauty and the grace of God. You've made this day a special day by just you being you. That's what he would famously say as he signed off. "There is no person in the world like you, and I like you just the way you are." Instead of cursing the darkness, Fred Rogers decided to cut holes in the darkness, letting the light of Christ shine through him. He sought to restore the world through impassioned creativity and craftsmanship. And for nearly four decades, he came into our homes and our hearts, every day leaving our neighborhoods a little bit more beautiful. My dear friends, that's what God wants us to do in our changing world. Don't be offended that sinners sin. Be provoked to do something positive, something countercultural. Don't curse the darkness. Shine the light of Christ into a world that so desperately needs him, especially through these changing times. You see, when God told Abram, "In you all the families of the earth shall be blessed," God was referring to Jesus Christ, who had come nearly 2,000 years later. And that's what we learn in Galatians chapter 3, verses 8 and 16. God was planning to bless the world through Abraham's seed, through a descendant of Abraham, and that descendant was Christ. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as well as the Son of Abraham, came into this world to die on a cross for our sins. 3 days later, he would rise again, and now he offers eternal life to anyone who believes in him. Jesus Christ is the source of every blessing, and it's only in him that people find life. It's not in you, it's not in me, but it's only through Jesus. It's not even in our personality or our charm or our gifts or our abilities. So if we're going to be a blessing to others, more than anything, we must share Christ to this world that's hurting. Amen. Well, I want to share this illustration. It's an illustration of one that I've shared before, but bear with me. It's from David Lenny. And he talks about Kon-Tiki in the Pacific. Thor Heyerdahl tells how he and a crew of five crossed the Pacific Ocean from South America to the South Pacific Islands on a crude raft of balsa logs bound together with hemp rope. During the three-month-long journey in 1947, they had little control of the direction of the raft and no way to stop its forward progress. They learned early in the voyage that anything dropped and overboard was almost impossible to recover once it passed behind the raft. 2 months into the voyage and thousands of miles away from land, Herman Watzinger lost his footing and went overboard. The raft, driven by a strong wind and heavy seas, moved ahead faster than he could swim. The five remaining men were horrified for their friend. They tried to throw him a life belt on a rope, but the wind blew it back at them. In seconds, Herman was all but lost to their sight in the tumble of waves. Suddenly, Knut Haugland grabbed the life belt and dove into the water. He swam back to Herman and wrapped his arm around him, holding his exhausted friend and the rope while the men on the boat drew them back to the boat. You see, for me, that's a beautiful picture of what God calls us to do today. With the currents of change carrying people so swiftly away, God calls us to jump into the water and take the life belt of Jesus to those who are perishing. For me, that's a beautiful picture of what God calls us to do today. With the currents of change carrying people so swiftly away, we are to dive in and help those people that are lost. In other words, go and be a blessing. In a rapidly changing world, don't retreat and complain and whine. Instead, move forward with the good news of Jesus Christ in word and deed and make a difference in people's lives. Now, before I share my reflection questions and pray, after this message, you'll have some very relevant testimonies of how God has used our church family, of how God has used his people to be a blessing during these changing times. And these are testimonies of thanksgiving that hopefully will encourage you. So, the two reflection questions for today. Number one, how has the Lord called you to be a blessing to others? How has the Lord called you to be a blessing to others? And number two, how has the Lord uniquely equipped you to cut holes in the spiritual darkness of our world? How has the Lord uniquely equipped you to cut holes in the spiritual darkness of our world? Let's pray. Father, we want to give you thanks. Thank you for this message. Thank you for these 8 months where you have been our guide through these transitions of change, these riptides of change. You have been our guide. You have been our lifeguard. We thank you, Lord, for guiding us and protecting us as a church. And Lord, we are indebted to you of how your Spirit has worked in our lives, of how you have called people to step up during these times of change, to be a source of hope and strength and encouragement. And Lord, I pray that this message this morning would bless people's hearts as we look forward to Thanksgiving. Lord, I pray that you would use your people in a mighty way, such that you would remind us that you are not done with us yet, regardless of our age, regardless of what we've done these last 8 months. Just as you used a 75-year-old man to be a blessing to the nations, I pray, Lord, you would use young and old to be a blessing to the nations, such that your name, our Lord Jesus Christ, would be lifted up and glorified. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're going to do in and through Thanksgiving. May we be a blessing to others as we remember all the things you have brought into our lives this past year and how you have led us and changed and transformed us into people of faith. And we thank you, Lord, for the joy of being your people as we celebrate this Thanksgiving as well as the church's anniversary. We give you all the glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, everybody. I'm here at my office, and I just wanted to just say thank you very much for praying for all of us who are on the forefront of the pandemic. It's a little scary coming in on a regular basis and trying to assess everybody. And at the same time, I'm just very thankful that God has been good and he has provided his protection to be upon us. I'm also just very thankful for the church family. I am thankful for my immediate family as well. I'm thankful for all my friends. And also, I just wanted to thank God so much for his love and his protection to be upon all of us, even during this time. Just remember that to take heart that he has overcome the world.
Hi, 各位弟兄姐妹，大家好，我是国语堂的贾娟。时间过得很快，从三月份到现在已经有快八个月，我们没有一起在教会敬拜了，很想念大家。虽然疫情开始之后，好像一切都变得非常的混乱，心里有很多的不安，但是神时刻在提醒我们要数算他的恩典，因为他的恩典够我们用，他的恩典让我们可以在绝望中看到盼望，特别是让基督徒在苦难中也可以荣耀他的名。我非常感恩的是，在今年三月份疫情开始爆发，医护人员 PPE 紧张的时候，神把爱人的心放在我们每一个人的心中，也赐给我们服侍人的机会和能力。我到现在都可以感受到当时弟兄姐妹迫切而火热的参与服侍的心。最开始国语堂的弟兄姐妹自发的开始购买口罩，购买面罩，然后从中国运到美国来分发给弟兄姐妹使用。然后我们开始把自己的这些物资分发给邻居，分发给身边有需要的人。到后来我们三堂一起开始了 PPE 的捐赠施工。我们筹款超过了$30,000，购买了近30,000个面罩、口罩，然后帮助了近30个的医院、养老院、警察局等抗疫在第一线的这些机构。我们同时也照顾到教会非常有身体需要的弟兄姐妹们，给他们留出很多物资来帮助他们日常的生活所用。虽然当时疫情非常的严重，但是当我们愿意冒着危险把这些物资亲自送到他们手中的时候，神真的是大大的祝福了我们。我们亲眼看到这些在第一线的医护人员真的是牺牲自己的健康，他们愿意服侍不分种族、不分国界，服侍那些新冠的病人。我们真是非常的感动，也真的是看到神按照他自己的样式把爱人的心放在每一个受造物的身上。那收到教会捐赠的每一个机构和每一个个人也都非常的感动，有的人还流泪。我想他们的感动和泪水不仅仅是因为这些物资可以给他们的身体提供更多的保护，而更多的是他们可以感受到我们基督徒在这样危险的时候还把他们放在心里，我们愿意尽自己的努力来爱他们。各位弟兄姐妹，我很想把这些医护人员他们的感动和泪水和你们分享，但是我知道我的言语是远远不够表达他们的感激之情的。我也特别感恩在 PPE 施工上神让我们三堂有合一的心一起同工， 有的人不分昼夜的联络工厂，有的人谨慎的比较口罩的质量，有的人为国际运输和清关各个复杂的环节担忧，还有更多的弟兄姐妹提供了自己的家庭住址来接收这些包裹，有的人在寒冷的车库中装箱打包，有的人日以继夜的开会来确定有 PPE 需要的机构，开车前往每一个机构亲自的把这些物资送到他们手上，还有更多的弟兄姐妹在网站上及时发布捐赠的信息和进展，让大家知道我们做的事是在荣耀神的。我希望大家可以明白，神在那个时间真的是大大的使用了中华友爱教会和教会的每一位弟兄姐妹。你们的热心，你们的劳苦，你们的捐款，你们的祷告都是荣耀神的。在感恩节来临之际，虽然我们不能在教会一起庆祝和敬拜，但是请你们给自己一个大大的拥抱，因为在这百年不遇的疫情当中，你们领受了圣灵的感动，一起同工，愿意服侍人，并且做得非常的棒，神必纪念你们的劳苦。最后祝大家感恩节快乐，希望我们可以早日在教会一起来敬拜他。
弟兄姊妹，感恩节快乐。2020年真是一个很特别的年份，我很想跟大家分享一下今年我的经历。我是一个洗肾员，我做了这份工已经有十几年了，所以这份工对我来说都没什么特别。今年二月份，我回香港探我爸爸啦。回到来之后呢，就发觉这种病毒呢开始传播得很紧要。我们的公司呢就开始开了一个叫做Isolation Clinic， 一做就在里面做了三个月了。究竟入 floor 的时候要有什么准备呢？去片
体温 OK， 得咗啦。咁咧就系呢个 OK 啦，冇事啦。OK， 然之后咧，要做得好快先。你唔会谂到咧，原来喺个 N95 后边咧要揸一个咁嘅嘢。
而我每一日翻工咧，系会做十到十二个钟头，而戴咗十二个钟头嗰个 N95 咧，嗰个样子就系咁噶啦。喺呢三个月里边，我自己一个人食饭，自己一个人休息，自己一个人自己同自己讲嘢，唔系话人哋唔同你讲嘢，而系咧唔系真系面对面咁同你沟通嘅。只可以打電話嗰啲寫下咁嘅啫。咁我唔舒服嘅時候，我覺得哎呀，我死啦！我自己都好驚，我係咪感染咗咧？咁樣咁我要去睇醫生嘅時候咧，醫生唔敢見我，我要自己去入去 ER 度睇醫生。而入 ER 咧都要自己一個人去，因為咧我隔離嗰個都好驚，唔知我係咪真係受到感染。而如果一齊去咧，佢又會驚受感染。咁所以咧，所有嘅嘢都係自己一個人做。其實係咪真係我自己一個人做咧？當然唔係啦。呢個世界上邊只有神係唔驚呢一種病毒。神陪我食飯，神陪我睇醫生，神陪我瞓覺傾偈，乜嘢嘅事情都係神陪住我去做。甚至乎我喺 floor 裏邊，我有時遇到一啲嘅危機。嗰啲嘅危機，我感覺到哇死啦！如果我掂埋去嘅時候，我可能會受感染嘅喎，都係神幫我一一嘅嚟到去，都係去做嗰個保護嘅工作。要多謝弟兄姊妹為我同埋為到前線嘅醫護人員嚟到祈禱，因為你哋嘅祈禱真係好重要，實在係 俾我哋有好大嘅力量同埋去同埋幫助同埋嗰個支持。咁我又要感謝神，因為神你為我解決咗一次又一次嘅危機，你亦都係俾我喺當中呢個過程裏邊，你係做咗好多好多保護嘅工作，我係知道嘅。天父，我感謝你，因為你俾我經歷。好像聖經裏面說，我不是風雲有你，而是親身地去經歷你。而我也好像有一首詩歌，今早做崇拜的時候，我聽到一首詩歌，他說，何往聽基督差遣，你擦亮我的生命，你擦亮我的生命，令到你叫我去哪我就去哪，我就聽你的差遣。我不是一定要做什麼大事，但是在這個過程裏面，我的而且確可以幫到那些受到感染到這種病毒的病人，而且我可以將我的愛，將我的能力來到照顧他們。所以我特別覺得很開心，我也覺得很值得，我更加要感謝神，因為在我幫助人的裏面，神你又幫助我，感謝主， Amen。
弟兄姐妹平安，感謝教會在感恩節之際给我有这个机会跟大家做感恩分享。我叫李艳霞，是一名病理科医生。今年三月份，我们整个科室的人都不幸感染了新冠，更加不幸的是，我也把病毒传染了给我14岁的儿子和86岁的老爸爸。我和儿子都很快恢复了，基本两个星期以后就差不多好了。但是86岁的老爸爸非常严重，后来入院三周，其中有9天的气管插管，又从医院转到一个康复中心，进行了近两个月的康复治疗，然后才回到家，继续的进行恢复。在爸爸生病住院和康复的这个整个过程中，真是非常惊心动魄的，我们经历了很多的焦急和忧虑，但是同时经历更多的是神的大能和带领。我想跟大家分享以下三点。第一点，死里逃生。大家都知道，患新冠最危险的就是老人。爸爸在家里患病以后就越来越严重，我们叫救护车把爸爸送进了医院，检查结果出来，爸爸患了新冠肺炎。爸爸越来越虚弱，因为他已经86岁高龄，通常这么大年纪，老人气管插管的效果不好，插管容易拔管难，因此医生有放弃治疗的想法，但是我们祷告后还是决定要尽一切的努力，不能放弃，因此决定让医院给爸爸做气管插管治疗。爸爸做了插管以后，有一段时间每天尝试拔管，都是失败告终。我们每天都在焦急的等待和祷告中度过，直到插管第8天以后，手巧的儿子给姥爷做了一个小十字架，送到姥爷的病房，给大家看，就是这个小十字架。感谢神垂听了我们的祷告。第2天，也就是插管9天以后，姥爷成功的拔管了。这实在是一个奇迹，86岁的爸爸在患重症新冠肺炎的情况下活过来了。第2点，坚强感恩的爸爸。爸爸是一个非常坚强的人，在整个的治疗过程中从来没有表现出一丝的抱怨和胆怯。刚到康复中心的第一天，护士打电话说，爸爸在床上试图翻身的时候掉到了地上，吓坏了我们。但是爸爸却在电话里非常镇定，跟我们说，不要埋怨护理人员，他们已经尽力做得很好了，要表扬他们。真的感谢神给爸爸这样宽容的心，我们的心里也得到了很多的安慰。整个住院和康复过程中，爸爸经历了很多艰难痛苦，尤其由于语言不通，听力又不好，交流很困难，但是神给爸爸智慧和胆量，用手势和简单的英语跟周围的人相处得非常好，他谦逊喜乐感恩的品格感染的周围的人，康复中心的人都非常的喜欢爸爸。爸爸后来跟我们分享说， 他在非常难受的时候，几次恳求上帝把他接走。有两次，他忽然感觉到极其轻松，所有的难受瞬间都消失了，身上无比的舒坦，好像到了一个美好的无比的地方。但是这种感觉非常短，一会儿就消失了，好像上帝给爸爸开了个门，让他看见天堂里面是什么样子，但是还没有到接他走的时候。后来我们都一致认为，神让爸爸继续活着，是为了要他继续做见证，要使用他。第三，祷告的大能。爸爸在住院和康复中心近三个月的时间里，教会的众弟兄姐妹每天不断地为我们祷告，在我们软弱的时候，在我们信心被考验的时候，在我因病毒传染给爸爸而自责的时候，兄弟姐妹们用祷告的洪水支持着我们一家往前走。我自己也是每天不断的祷告，在祷告中，神一次又一次的添给我力量和信心。由于爸爸住院和康复中心都是需要隔离的，我们无法探视，神给我智慧，让我想到一个办法，就是每天给爸爸写信送过去，让护士交给他。我在信里面告诉他，我们爱他，神爱他。我每天给他写圣经的经文和祷告文，爸爸在神的话语中充满了平安，一天比一天好。爸爸从康复中心出院的时候，我数了一下，总共给他写了50多封信。爸爸把信放在一个文件夹里，小心翼翼地收藏着，时不时拿出来一遍一遍地读。这些信对我和爸爸来讲是如此的宝贵，字里行间表达了我作为女儿对爸爸的爱，但同时也是神的大能和恩典的记录。爸爸回家以后，我们又开始每晚一起跟爸爸学圣经了。何等感恩！回顾抗疫一路过来，虽然坎坷艰难，但是感谢神，也让我们在苦难中为他做见证，传扬他的名。神从来没有应许我们一生顺利没有苦难，但是神会在困境中领引我们。我们抓住圣经，抓住神的话语，不断的祷告，真的感受到神给我们无限的平安。感谢弟兄姐妹们。
Thank you.
Glad you could join us for this special Thanksgiving service. Yes, we do miss you, but we have a lot to be thankful for as a community as well as families. And hopefully you were encouraged by all that you heard today, by God's word as well as the testimonies and worship. And I pray that this Thanksgiving, you would not forget God's word to you, to move ahead and to be a blessing. Now receive the benediction. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forevermore. Amen. Happy Thanksgiving and go in peace.